Hello everyone, it's SpawnPoiint and welcome back to another video. And this is the base spec 14-inch MacBook Pro, which I've been using over the last week. It's got the M1 Pro chip, 16GB of RAM and a 512GB SSD, which means it's not only the smallest and cheapest 2021 model, it's the lowest spec version available. But what's it like for editing videos and photos on? Is the screen too small? Are there any downsides to picking this over the larger 16-inch model? And is it really worth it? Well, I think this is the sleeper one to buy this year. Now, when it comes to choosing between the 14-inch and the 16-inch model, it essentially comes down to two things, the screen size and the cost. Is it worth going for that larger model? Well, the good news is the 14-inch M1 MacBook Pro shares the same new features from the 16, including the new ports, ProMotion display, speakers, and design. Today's video is about the 14-inch model and how capable it is, but I will make a few comparisons to the 16 to hopefully help you decide which is the best choice for you. Taking a quick look at the box, as you can see here, this is the base spec that I've got. The M1 Pro in space grey with an 8-core CPU, a 14-core GPU, 16GB of RAM and a 512GB SSD. Now, just like with the 16-inch model, the 14-inch comes with the new MagSafe to USB charging cable. We've got the usual paperwork, including some new black Apple stickers. We've also got the plug and the power brick, and this one here is the 67-watt version. And that's everything that we get inside the box. Having used both the 14 and the 16-inch over the last week or so, I've really come to like this new design. The aluminium case with the smooth, rounded edges look nice, and I like the overall flat design, especially with this matte finish. If we flip it over, there's the new MacBook Pro branding etched onto the bottom, which adds a nice touch. This new branding actually replaces the MacBook Pro text that we'd normally see below the screen. Flipping it over again, on the top we've got the new Apple logo. Now this is a little bit bigger than what we've had before, but overall I do like the new design of the 2021 MacBook Pro. A huge advantage of the 14-inch Pro over the 16-inch is the overall size. It just feels easier to hold and move around, especially one-handed. Now, it definitely feels a lot more portable, especially comparing that to the 16-inch model, which feels a little bit big and bulky. That means if you wanted to carry this around to work or school, the smaller form is going to make your life that little bit easier. So obviously the 14-inch is smaller than the 16-inch, and when you're looking at the dimensions on the website, you can see there's a few centimeters here and there. But to give you an idea of the actual size, here it is compared to the 16-inch model. It's only by seeing the two side by side that you appreciate just how much bigger the 16-inch model is. On paper, the thickness between the two is actually only 1mm, but in reality, it's not noticeable at all. As for the weight, the 14-inch is actually 25% lighter, but they both feel pretty heavy when picking them up. So with that in mind, as I've been moving around the house, if portability is a big part of your day, the 14-inch is a great choice. Plus, it takes up less space in your bag and on your desk. Now the screen on this is absolutely incredible. The first thing you'll notice, or at least I did, was just how bright and vibrant the screen looks. It's got a liquid retina XDR screen powered by mini LEDs, and it's got that new ProMotion 120Hz display. But this screen is perfect for working on. Over the last week, I've been using it to create videos in Final Cut Pro and editing photos in Lightroom. Everything has looked awesome. It shares the same brightness of 1000 nits and a peak brightness of 1600 nits. Plus the wide color gamut means everything just looks better. This screen is a noticeable step up from the previous MacBooks that we've seen. Now it does have a 120Hz screen, although not everything is supported. In fact, most of the apps that I've been using, they don't get above 60. I assume this is just like with this year's iPhones, developers will need to optimize their apps for this new frame rate. It's supposed to be adaptive though, which means it won't always run at 120. It could be 24 or 60, depending on what you're doing. But this is a good thing as it means it will help with your battery usage. Talking about the screen, if you've ever watched my living room setup tour or the TV reviews that I've done recently, you'll know that I'm currently using the 77-inch LG C1 OLED, and this is by far the best TV that I've ever owned. In fact, I actually did a dedicated review just on this C1 OLED a few months back. Well, it's currently on sale at the moment, so if you're interested in picking up this TV or the smaller 55 or 65-inch version, make sure you click the link in the description to see the latest offers. Now, one of the biggest differences between the 14 and the 16-inch model when it comes down to screen size is the screen real estate. What I mean by this is if you're working on a video, photo, or design, you want as much screen as possible to work with. I actually usually edit straight from my Mac or I plug it into an external display. I'm currently using this LG 32-inch monitor. But for the last 2 days, I wanted to really test out the size of this screen, so I've exclusively used the 14-inch model. Now, after that initial feeling of this is just too small, I can't work with this, I did get used to it and I actually started to enjoy it. I could honestly comfortably edit and work from this 14-inch model if I didn't have another display. In fact, the latest video that's on my channel, which is the PlayStation 5 headset review, was completely edited on this MacBook and I had no issues with it at all. Now, when comparing the two screens side by side, you can really see just how much smaller the 14-inch is. I was actually amazed at how small it looks. It practically looks like an iPad alongside a MacBook. It's worth mentioning though that obviously the overall screen size and the real estate is different between the two, but we're also seeing a lot less information on the screen. It's not just a different resolution. That means different menus and settings that you might normally see in Final Cut Pro or Lightroom, you might need to scroll to access those. But for me, coming from either using the larger MacBook or a 32-inch monitor, I find the 14-inch screen just slightly too small for my everyday needs. That's not to say the screen is worse, it's the same reason that I go for the iPhone Pro Max models over the normal Pro. I feel the larger screens make it easier to work, and when I'm being creative, I don't want the screen size to compromise that. But if portability is the main reason that you need a MacBook Pro, the 14-inch is lighter, smaller, and easier to carry around. Plus, if you're going to be using it docked and plugged into a larger screen anyway, this one makes perfect sense as you don't need that 16-inch screen. We can't talk about the screen and not mention the notch. So yes, at the top, we've got the new notch, which is housing a 1080p HD camera. There's no Face ID, which is disappointing, but I guess we'll get that next time as the main selling point. I mentioned in my 16-inch unboxing video that the notch would take me some getting used to. Well, I can safely say that after about 9 minutes, I've already forgotten about it and I no longer even look at it. The only issue that I've faced is the way that some menus in certain apps will be displayed across the top. You may find that the menu actually needs to be split across the notch. So as you're going across the menu, it will then jump over the notch to get to the other side. On the whole though, this screen looks absolutely incredible, and whether you're creating content, watching content, or just browsing, everything looks so nice. The 16-inch model that I have here is the M1 Max with 32GB of RAM, which means comparing that to the M1 Pro with 16GB of RAM seems a little unfair. But with the tests and the normal everyday tasks that I use my MacBook for, the lowest spec version ran absolutely fine. In fact, the fans never kicked in once, and it didn't struggle with anything. So what I did was I actually set both these MacBooks up exactly the same from a Time Machine backup. This way I could run the same tests on both. Now today's video isn't a side-by-side comparison of the M1 Pro versus the M1 Max, but I wanted to demonstrate why I think the cheapest and smallest MacBook is still awesome and can easily hold its own. Generally speaking, using the two side-by-side for different tasks like YouTube and checking emails and writing scripts, there was no difference at all, but that's no surprise. Then I decided to take a previous video that I've exported and uploaded to see how fast they can do it. So the project that I'll be using is a 4K project. It's been recorded on my iPhone and then edited on the Mac. Okay, first up, let's take a look at the 16-inch M1 Max. As I scrub through the 4K content, it plays and loads perfectly. Even with multiple layers, there's no lag at all. But that's no surprise as we are on the Max model. Okay, so this video when exported will be 9 minutes and 26 seconds long, and it'll be roughly 3.6 gigabytes in size. Now what we're going to do is we're going to export this to see how long it takes. I can tell you during the export process, the fans did not kick in once, something that my Intel MacBook would have done within a few seconds. Okay, so in total, this took 3 minutes and 22 seconds to export. That's pretty impressive. I'd love to do a comparison against my old Intel MacBook to see how slow that would have been. Next up, we've got the 14-inch M1 Pro. And same as before, we've got the same project and video, and I'd want to see how well it scrubs through the content, and it's absolutely perfect. No difference here at all, and again, this is the base spec MacBook Pro. Now we'll get this exported and see if the fans kick in, as well as how long it will take. We've got 3 minutes and 22 seconds to compare to. Okay, so during the export, there was no fan noise at all. It was whisper quiet. And the export took 5 minutes and 19 seconds in total. That's 2 minutes slower than the M1 Max. And honestly, for me, that is absolutely incredible. That means that the M1 Pro chip would be more than enough for the tasks that I need. This has massively impressed me today. Now, if you're shooting in 8K or you're editing layer upon layer of content in Final Cut Pro, maybe the M1 Max will be more suitable. But assuming that most of us don't need that requirement, the M1 Pro chip is more than enough for you. One of the big selling points for this year's MacBook Pros are the ports are back. On the left side, we've got the MagSafe port again. This is easier, quicker, and safer to charge. The cable now just clicks into place, and once it's charging, you get a little LED on the top that lights up. To remove it, I just press down or pull up on the cable and it will easily disconnect. The magnets are pretty strong, so it's worth mentioning don't just pull the cable like this as it will probably pull your MacBook across the table. There are also two Thunderbolt 4 USB-C ports and a headphone jack. This new headphone jack now provides support for high impedance headphones. If that's something that you use, it will provide better sound quality via those compatible headphones. Now, if you're using a MacBook to create and edit video or photo content, there's a good chance that the new SD card slot will be for you. I've not actually used my camera for over a year now, as I use my iPhone for all photos and videos that you see, but it's still good to have this port back. Then there's another Thunderbolt 4 USB-C port and an HDMI out. Now, this is not an HDMI 2.1, so if you want to connect it to an external display for that full 4K 120Hz, you'll be better off using one of the Thunderbolt ports instead. Another added benefit this year is with all of these ports, it means no more dongles. Looking at the new keyboard, the 14-inch model has the same keypad as the 16-inch. They are the same size and the same layout. So even though the overall max size is a lot smaller, it's awesome that you get the same full-size keyboard. I really like the look of this new design with the all black keys and the black backing. You'll also notice that there's no more touch bar across the top. This was something that I used on my old MacBook, but after a few days, I've already got used to not having it. And do you know what? I actually prefer having the physical keys now for the volume and the brightness. Now these keys feel really nice to type on, and they feel a lot more responsive than the butterfly keys we've had. The feedback and the key travel is perfect for such a low profile key. They also have a backlight on the keys, and you can turn these on and off or adjust them in the control center. But if you're like me, there's a good chance you might be using a Bluetooth keyboard with your Mac, in which case you're not really going to be using this keyboard. The trackpad on Macs are awesome anyway, but one thing to note about the 14-inch version is it's a little bit smaller than the 16. This does look noticeable when comparing them side by side, but having used the smaller one for the last week, it's absolutely fine and no issue to use. Again, if you're using an external mouse or trackpad, this won't really matter. In the top right, we've still got Touch ID. You can use this to log into the Mac or to make purchases. And if you tap the outer edge, this is what actually locks the screen. And if you gently press the center, this is what unlocks it. Generally speaking, laptop speakers aren't great, but both of these have the same 6-speaker setup, and they sound awesome. I wasn't actually expecting them to sound quite as good as they do. They have what's called force-canceling woofers, and the bass, clarity, and sound stage is incredible. Here's a quick demo of both the 14-inch and the 16-inch speakers to see what you think. I really think they sound incredible, easily the best speakers I've ever heard on a laptop or Mac. Just like with the iPhones, the bigger version comes with a bigger battery, so the 14-inch comes with a 70-watt battery, while the 16-inch has a 100-watt battery. I've been using this on battery, and it will easily last me an entire day without charging. In fact, the video that I uploaded on my channel last, that Sony headset review, that was fully edited while on battery. And if you go for the base spec like I have here, the 14-inch version comes with a 67-watt charger. You can, for £20 or $20, you can upgrade that to the 96-watt charger instead. That's what's normally included in the 10-core CPU or the M1 Max. Only the 16-inch model comes with a 140-watt power adapter. And as shown earlier, the MagSafe adapter is great. I absolutely love this. And if you wanted to, you can still use the USB-C port to charge. So it means you can stick with a one cable setup when connected to an external display. I've already mentioned the spec of this 14-inch model, and as you can see on screen here, this is the cheapest spec you can choose right now. But even this base spec model is more powerful and better spec than the previous entry-level models. But it's not cheap. I mean, you could opt for the previous 13-inch M1 and save about £600. But as soon as you try to match the 14-inch model in terms of spec, including the 16GB of RAM and a 512 SSD, you may as well go for the new 14-inch M1 Pro. You're getting an overall better MacBook, including the better screen, extra ports, speakers, and the new chip. So the ultimate question is, would I recommend going for the new MacBook Pro? Well, my advice would be, if you do any kind of creative work with an editing software, whether that's photo, video, or design, the Pro is the way to go. But in terms of which size to go for, this is how I would summarize it. If it's the only screen that you're going to use, and you're unlikely going to be plugging it into a larger screen, and it will live on your desk most of the time, the 16-inch model makes the most sense. It's got a bigger screen and a slightly better battery along with that bigger trackpad. It will then be the biggest and best screen that you currently own. But if it's going to be docked most of the time and plugged into a monitor, or is going to be carried to school, work, or clients regularly, the 14-inch is the ultimate portability machine. It's packing the same spec as the 16 in this tiny form factor. Then finally, it comes down to price. Well, the 16-inch model is around £500 more, like for the same spec. And all you're getting is a larger display and an increased battery. But again, if this MacBook is going to live on your desk while plugged into a monitor and running from mains power, those could be two features that you just don't need. So even though I have the 16-inch model, I think the 14-inch MacBook Pro is the one to buy, especially where form factor and price is of concern. But before I bought the 16-inch, I did wonder if I could downsize from my 15 to the 14, but having used that for the last week, I personally feel the 16 is a better choice for me. And what about you? What size or spec would you go for? If you let me know in the comments, I will give you a thumbs up for staying until the end. And also, any questions you've got about these two new MacBooks, please let me know in the comments too. I hope today's video was useful, and here's another video you might be interested in watching next. Don't forget to hit that like button, subscribe to the channel, and turn notifications on so you don't miss my next upload. You can also follow me over on Instagram and Twitter. Until next time.